Funding for NEOtropolis has been provided by the Burton D. Morgan Foundation, with a mission to strengthen the free enterprise system by investing in organizations and institutions that foster the entrepreneurial spirit. Key Private Bank, offering a broad, integrated, and objective perspective on managing wealth, with more than a century of banking, trust, and investment expertise. Key Private Bank is on the web at key.com/KPB.
Magnet, the manufacturing advocacy and growth network, supports and champions manufacturing in Northern Ohio through product development and consulting services that help companies grow in today's global economy. Information online at magnetwork.org.
Kent State University, one of Ohio's premier universities, celebrating 100 years as an engine for economic, cultural, and workforce development. That's excellence in action. It's happening every day at Kent State University. Information available at kent.edu.
The Dominion Foundation. JumpStart, working with entrepreneurs to accelerate the growth of their high-potential businesses to create a more prosperous economic future for Northeast Ohio. The Raymond John Wean Foundation.
You think we're in a recession? But we found a company that's struggling to find a skilled workforce here in Northeast Ohio. Learn more straight ahead. Hi, I'm Thomas Mulready, and thanks for watching our first edition of NEOtropolis, an interactive show focusing on the very latest business and financial news throughout Northeast Ohio. You may be tuning in expecting to see Newsnight Akron, which has aired in this time slot for more than 10 years. That show's been moved to 9:30, directly following NEOtropolis. So please, stay with us. We have an exciting show for you. By tuning in to NEOtropolis every Friday night, you can expect to learn a lot about economic development in the entire Northeast Ohio region, like new and emerging business ventures, business incubators and entrepreneurship, how area companies are created, and how they grow. Plus, you'll take part in some lively discussions because each segment will be analyzed by a roundtable of panelists. We're teaming up with the region's most read and most trusted business publications, including Crane's Cleveland Business and the Business Journal in Youngstown. Our goal is to appeal to everyone, whether you're an expert in the business world or just hoping to learn a little bit more about the economic climate of the cities and towns here in Northeast Ohio. Also, we want to hear from you about your ideas, your questions, and your concerns. So log on to neotropolis.org, friend us on Facebook, and follow us on Twitter. After all, it's your region, too. So let's take a look at some headlines from around the region. Down the drain, the city of Akron last week reached an agreement with the Environmental Protection Agency, which is expected to end a federal lawsuit targeting Akron's sewer system overflows, which pollute local waterways, including the Cuyahoga River and the Ohio and Erie Canal. City leaders have already said that the 19-year project will cost at least $500 million, and sewer customers are expected to see their rates double or even triple to cover their costs. All's well in Canton this week, as a new labor contract went into effect when steelworkers overwhelmingly ratified a 4-year agreement with the Timken Company. The contract was approved by an almost 5-to-1 margin. Reportedly, the biggest sticking point was health care and pension for future hires. Those benefits, along with wages, will be reduced for people to be hired under the new contract. More steel ahead for the Mahoning Valley. Youngstown Mayor Jay Williams said he believes the Mahoning Valley site for a proposed V&M Star steel expansion is a preferential site for the project. The company is expected to decide sometime during the next 3 months whether it will move forward with a $970 million expansion in the Mahoning Valley. And this will be remembered as the week organized gambling finally came to Ohio. On Tuesday, the statewide Issue 3 passed decisively, meaning casinos will be open in Columbus, Toledo, Cincinnati, and Cleveland within 24 to 36 months. Beyond the obvious construction jobs, however, the actual economic impact of the casinos is difficult to predict, with competition from 24 existing casinos within an hour's drive of Ohio's borders, already slumping with the economy. And while the measure puts casinos in the center of Ohio's biggest cities, observers will have to wait to see if the much-discussed economic spin-off benefits downtown restaurants and attractions. Ohio received some welcome validation this week as Site Selection magazine claimed the state has the fourth best business climate in the country, beating out Tennessee, North Carolina, and both coasts. The survey of executives indicated three reasons Ohio is so desirable as a location for new plant construction: the state's well-developed transportation infrastructure and access, existing workforce skills, and a favorable state and local tax environment. Now with us tonight to discuss these headlines and more are Beju Shah, president and CEO of BioEnterprise in Cleveland, David Axon, author and president of Sonax Group in Bath, and Dr. Michael Scope, president of Cuyahoga Community College Metro Campus. So, Ohio has the fourth best business climate in the nation. This might come as a surprise to people who are complaining about our industrial workforce and especially about our perceived high taxes. David, how important is this number four ranking in Site Selection magazine?
Hey, it's a lot better than being number five. It's a question of what we do with this ranking. What do we do about promoting, marketing, and selling Northeast Ohio as a perfect region for organizations and businesses to relocate? You know, I travel a lot. When I'm lying in my hotel room, Michigan is promoting itself as the biotech capital of North America. Maybe that should be Northeast Ohio. We clearly have the academic and the industrial infrastructure to support that growth. We need to do a better job of promoting it.
Michael, how about our skilled workforce? Should we do a better job of promoting that as well? Do we get a bad rap that everyone here is just industrial workers left over from the Industrial Revolution?
Absolutely. I think we have that narrative in our head. And I think other people across the country have that narrative of Cleveland as and Akron as old steel towns. But in fact, we have a dozen universities here that give us one of the most educated workforces, in addition to having a traditional workforce with a very high level of skill.
Beju, is this news surprising to you, or is this the way it should be?
Well, it is certainly the way it should be. In the last few years, we've been able to move companies here from places like California and Massachusetts, but also from North Carolina and from Texas and Georgia. And they're coming here for the workforce, as Michael alluded to, for a great tax environment, and most importantly, for a vibrant business environment.
That's great. Now let's turn to the stock report with our finance expert, Kevin Meyeroff. He's CEO of NCA Financial Planners in Mayfield and has been ranked by Barron's Magazine as one of the top 100 financial advisors in the United States. What's the latest, Kevin?
Good evening. We're going to talk about five different stocks today. The first two we're going to look at are manufacturing. I like to look at manufacturing stocks because they're really a leading indicator if we're starting to come out of this recession. And we have a number of good manufacturing companies here in Cleveland, and two of them we're going to focus on tonight. First is Eaton Corporation, located right here in Cleveland, Ohio. Their midweek close was $62.89. 52 weeks, so after over the whole last year, they were as low as $30.02 and as high as $65.71. Over the last year, they've gained a positive 26.51 year to date, and over the last 3 years, they've lost about 11.97%. The second company, located right here in Mayfield Heights, Ohio, is Parker Hannifin. Parker Hannifin's midweek close is $54.53. Their 52-week range is as low as $27.69 and as high as $59.36. Their year-to-date is up 28.19%, and over 3 years, they're still positive, barely 0.82. Healthcare, great healthcare company right here in Cleveland, Ohio, Steris and Mentor, Ohio, to be exact. And Steris is really benefiting from some of the stuff going on with H1N1 and the scare of the flus. You could see that their midweek close was $33. The last 52 weeks, they've been as low as $19.20 and as high as $35.75. For the year-to-date, they're up a whopping 38.13%, but over the last 3 years, they're still down 4.38%. J.M. Smucker's, a safety stock. It's a place where people put their money because even in bad times, we still have to have our jelly. We might not need some televisions, but our jelly we have to have. In Orville, Ohio, its midweek close was $52.04. Over the last 52 weeks, it's been as low as $34.09 and as high as $55.36. Year-to-date, they're up 20.02% and a really nice three-year return of 6.92%. Last but not least is KeyCorp, located here in Cleveland, Ohio. The financial service industry has really been hurt, and KeyCorp was not spared in this financial service crisis that we're having. Their midweek close was $5.32. Over the last 52 weeks, they've been as low as $4.40 and as high as $13.85. Year-to-date, they're down 37.56, and wow, 3 years, they're down 85.5%.
This week, we had the opportunity to meet with Tom Murphy, the president and COO of Benvenue Laboratories. Instead of considering layoffs or even tightening their belt, like many in this region, this Bedford company is in the unusual position of struggling to find qualified workers to fill their ranks. Let's learn more.
Benvenue is a pharmaceutical manufacturer. We specialize in injectable products, so these are products that come in vials, not tablets or capsules or pills that you normally pick up at a drugstore. Our products are typically used in a hospital setting. We've won the North Coast 99 Award 9 times. The reason you receive those kind of awards is because of the programs that you have in place for employees, the types of things that you offer them, maybe outside of what other companies may offer. So it's an ongoing thing, and it's we don't do it to win awards. We do it because it's the right way to treat employees. It's the right way to attract and retain employees. And as you know, it's very expensive to hire people, but it's even more expensive to lose them and have to rehire. We've been working with some of the local communities and local colleges, Tri-C to name one. We've worked with them to put together a program where they bring in individuals who learn the pharmaceutical manufacturing processes. And in fact, we have some of our employees who teach down there.
Well, I've been working with Tri-C for about 2.5 years, helped develop the teaching program. We've helped them specify some pieces of equipment to buy to help with the course. And then since then, I've gone down and helped teach it.
We have about 70 programs at Tri-C. And so through those 70 programs, our many years of working with the community have a multitude of great partnerships. We view partnerships as a good way to forge economic development for the region. And as we look towards partnerships, those partners tell us in terms of curriculum development, they provide work-based learning opportunities. It is important to connect with an employer prior to completion of training.
We're able to help teach students that come into Tri-C who wouldn't normally have any access into pharmaceutical manufacturing. We're able to help and instruct them and get them familiar with what those standards are. So when they come to interview and a possible job, they've got some insight and some prior knowledge.
The significant thing about Benvenue and other pharmaceutical companies was the fact that they were willing to become part of our advisory committee. So in addition to just telling us they needed to gain qualified, trained employees, they in fact said to us, we would help you design curriculum that was real time and relevant to what we need today.
So David, I thought we were in an economic downturn, and now here we listen to Benvenue talk about how expensive it is to find new workers, to retrain their workers. Which is it?
I think it's a good issue because we're creating high-tech jobs in this region, and that requires a set of skills that maybe historically have not been in rich supply. We need to develop those skill sets. Our economy in the region is really going through a second inflection point. We had the transition from manufacturing-based economy to one that was more service-centric. Now we're getting an addition of a third component, which is a science and technology-based economy. These create very rich jobs, very worthwhile positions, and therefore making the investment in our region around education and training, maybe through programs that allow people to shadow within the organization, partnerships with the education community, can really drive the development of those skill sets. It's not like you're just walking out of a car plant and walking into pharmaceutical manufacturing.
Right.
These are highly skilled jobs,
sure.
And we have to make the investment to create those skill sets in our community.
Beiju, are you finding this with the biomedical companies? They're finding it difficult to find these skill sets?
I think the thing that is surprising is in this environment, our companies are struggling to find workers. They're struggling to find individuals that have not only the experience in an industry, but have a willingness and desire to get the training that David talked about to become a part of an industry. If you take a company like Benvenue Laboratories, they're, as David said, you can't translate directly from one manufacturing environment to another. It's just like any other industry. You have to learn the process. You have to learn the terminology, learn the way things are done, which is different in an FDA-regulated environment than it is in automotive or industrial.
I think what that speaks to really is David was talking about the economy going through a transformation. And in fact, our business, education, is going through a similar kind of transformation. It's not the case where you go to school and then you go to work and you never go back to school again. We all know about lifelong learning. What we're just beginning to understand is that education has to have a much stronger, much closer partnership with business, so you don't wait until the jobs appear. You really are part of the process of supporting emerging industries.
Michael, how willing is the workforce to make this migration? Are they cooperating? Are they getting the fact that they need to be retrained in these new skills, or are you finding it difficult?
I think people really increasingly are recognizing across the board that they not only need to be trained for the new and emerging jobs, but that they need to continue to go back to school to upgrade their skills. I think in some ways that's demonstrated through record enrollments that our and many other institutions have experienced.
We should recognize there's a challenge here as well. A lot of people who have lost their jobs recently have 15, 20, 25 mm-hmm. years in a single company.
Yeah.
Coming out of the automotive industry and the decimation that's
right.
occurred in that sector,
right.
you can't take someone's 45, 50, as old as I am and simply retrain them overnight. It's very difficult.
Right.
We need to create those types of programs that allow for late career transitions. We do a very good job with the young people. They come up with a much more flexible attitude. They don't expect a job for life. They expect a career of a lot of different experiences. They're more comfortable with that. But we have a significant number of people who've lost their jobs in our region recently who feel very, very uncomfortable and actually feel like they're almost a failure at the moment.
Right.
And it takes a little bit to get over that hump, and we really need to create some tools and programs to help them do that.
The other thing we're seeing in this downturn is a lot of white-collar job dislocation as well as blue-collar job dislocation.
Right.
It's as important for the white-collar workers to realize that if they want to participate in an industry like healthcare or in the high-tech field, they too have a continuous learning process that they have to engage in. And if they want to jump into a new field, they might not jump in at the same level they were in a finance industry or in an automotive industry, but with training and time, they can regain that same position over.
So it's a real dislocation for everyone here. What's at stake, David? I mean, if we don't make this transition successfully, globally, you travel the world, what's at stake for this region?
Someone else will make the transition for us, and those jobs will move out of our region. Those companies will move out of our region. We are not just competitive with Michigan and Pennsylvania and Kentucky and the states that surround us. We're competing with Asia. We're competing with Eastern Europe, who are creating engineers at a higher level of education than we are in many situations. So we have a real challenge here. We can fight for those jobs. We have some inherent advantages. But if we don't start creating the right environment, these types of organizations are doing today, we're going to lose that battle. But the opportunity is there to grow real high-quality jobs and careers for people in our region. But we have probably 5 years to get our act together.
Now, one of the great things about our region is its entrepreneurial spirit, something that goes back to Dr. Benjamin Franklin Goodrich, John D. Rockefeller, and Charles Brush. Over the next few weeks, we'll be introducing our viewers to some of the growing companies found in our area's business incubators. We'll continue to follow these companies over the next year to see how they're progressing and to see how they handle the hurdles that come their way. Lydia Esparra visits our first company in Akron.
Thanks, Thomas. You're going to meet Bill McCroskey. He's an inventor, and he's come up with some medical imaging technology that's going to make claustrophobics like me jump for joy.
In the Northeast Ohio area, we are the mecca of medical imaging. And many people don't realize that, but the first medical imaging systems of all the modalities were developed here in the Northeastern Ohio area. FMI Technologies, the word letters FMI stands for Fused Multimodality Imaging. And really in our products we have three imaging modalities in one system. We like to say in our system there's no claustrophobia compared to traditionally tunnels in magnetic resonance imaging systems. And we designed the machines for patient comfort, and we provide one-stop imaging. There are three major large competitors for medical imaging, and those are Philips Medical, which is here in the Northeast Ohio. The second is General Electric Medical Systems, or healthcare. And the third is Siemens Medical Systems. Each of these companies are focused on whole body imaging systems, and they are not focused on organ-specific systems. In the next 6 months, FMI would like to continue the development of the SentiStar neural system and the SentiStar cardiac system. We are currently raising a Series A financing to pay for that. We would like to take those machines within 9 months to local clinical trial sites, including Akron General Medical Center, Cleveland Clinic, and the University of Pittsburgh. And with that, we would like to get FDA approval on the systems in about 1 year. Within about a year and a half of the funding, we hope to be revenue generating and become profitable and producing the systems both in the SensiStar Cardiac as well as the SensiStar Neural.
Bill's been in the inventing business for some 30 years now, and every few months we're going to come over here and check in on him and see how it's working, and see how it's working for Northeast Ohio. In Akron, I'm Lydia Aspara.
Beiju, these guys, FMI, they're really pushing the envelope with medical imaging. Is that really such a big industry here in Northeast Ohio, and if so, why?
In Northeast Ohio right now, we have over 60 companies in the medical imaging industry and probably over 4,000 workers, Phillips Medical being the largest of those companies, but also Hitachi Medical is here, Toshiba's here, GE Healthcare has some divisions that are here in Northeast Ohio. And the reason really traces back to entrepreneurs. There's entrepreneurs back in the 1950s and 60s that started a series of companies called Picker X-Ray, and Technicare, and Ohio Nuclear that have grown up over time to become leaders in medical imaging, having been acquired up to now what is called Phillips Medical. But those entrepreneurs and the success that they had spawned this entire cluster of medical imaging.
David, does it also help to have these huge partners, medical centers like the Cleveland Clinic, University Hospital, Summa Healthcare in this region? How important is that?
It's absolutely crucial. You know, we're in the Cuyahoga Valley. We're not in Silicon Valley. But you look at how Silicon Valley developed. It was on the back of Hewlett-Packard that was founded there in the 1920s. It was on the back of very large defense contractors that were based in California, brought in a lot of engineering talent. And then you had Stanford University, really, as the hub of the academic engine that was driving growth in Silicon Valley. You can see what's happening with polymer technology and with medical imaging technology in our region has very similar parallels to what happened in California. We need to try and exploit that, nurture that, and help it grow even further. And we can create that critical mass that brings together academia, brings together business, and brings together investment and innovation to really create some opportunities for the future for our region.
Michael, how about workforce development in this field, in medical imaging? Are we on the ball here? Are we training our workers properly?
I think absolutely. We have partnerships with the Cleveland Clinic. We have partnerships with the University Hospital. We have great depth of expertise, not just inside of our doors, but with our private industry partners.
Beiju, talk about this sort of tech belt that has been referenced between Cleveland and Pittsburgh, really, all the way through Youngstown. Is this something that we're seeing come about recently in terms of being recognized nationally, internationally?
Yeah, one of the things that's surprising to people, not just here in Northeast Ohio, but certainly outside of Northeast Ohio, is how close the two geographies are, the fact that they're actually adjacent. And if you look at the total number of medical firms, medical institutions, research universities, community colleges, trained engineers and technical workers in this geography, it rivals some of the top regions in the world. And it goes back to what David said earlier, it's about now marketing that fact out to industry so industry realizes that this is a great place for them to set up their operations and businesses to succeed.
And there's a great point related to that. The whole healthcare domain, it's driven by demographics. We know what's going to happen. We've got 77 million baby boomers who are going to start hitting 65 in the next year or so. That creates a demand because we're living longer and we need more medical care and support. There's built-in demand growth for many of these technologies that our region is beginning to invest in. So this could create a sustainable economy for 10, 20, 30 years, which is exactly what we need in the region.
In high technology industry, it's really an intersection of a lot of different sciences and disciplines. So you take the robotics and computer technology out of Carnegie Mellon, the material sciences out of Akron, the physics, engineering, and healthcare out of the Cleveland institutions, and it's the marriage of all of those three disciplines that creates the novel medical imaging companies like an FMI.
Well, and I think one of the things we sometimes forget is that high-tech manufacturing is still manufacturing. That is really
right.
the ability to manufacture to very high level of precision, things like optics,
right.
That exists in Northeast Ohio, and that's not easy to acquire.
And a company like Phillips Medical still manufactures their CTs and MRs here in Northeast Ohio because they need the type of skilled workforce that we still have here in the United States. They cannot ship this overseas.
So So it really is still manufacturing in a lot of ways. It may be scaled down. They may be in clean rooms now with white lab coats on, but it's essentially a very similar kind of an industry.
Absolutely. And I think we can build on that historical strength in manufacturing and the real depth of expertise that we have that, as Beju said, is rooted right here in Northeast Ohio.
Talk quickly about these accelerators, incubators. David, are they important?
I think they're absolutely essential. There was some research done not too long ago, 2005, that basically said these incubators have created over 100,000 jobs. What do we need in the U.S. economy today? What do we need in the Northeast Ohio economy? The economics are such that the best investment government can make in creating new jobs is to support entrepreneurial activity. We should be seeing stimulus dollars moving in this direction. We should be seeing the state and local government authorities really supporting these incubators. Yes, some will fail, but you only need one or two to succeed, and you create sustainable, high-quality jobs that can be great for our region and great for the families in our region.
Thanks for your comments, gentlemen. Thanks so much for watching our premiere edition of NEOtropolis. We'll discuss weekly business and financial news of the entire Northeast Ohio region every Friday night at 9 o'clock. And remember, you can find us on Facebook, Twitter, and the web at neotropolis.org. This is Thomas Mulready. Have a great weekend in Northeast Ohio. Newsnight Akron is next.
Funding for NEOtropolis has been provided by the Burton D. Morgan Foundation, committed to the free enterprise system. Key Private Bank, offering a broad, integrated, and objective perspective on managing wealth with more than a century of banking, trust, and investment expertise. Key Private Bank is on the web at key.com/KPB.
Magnet, the manufacturing advocacy and growth network, supports and champions manufacturing in Northern Ohio through product development and consulting services that help companies grow in today's global economy. Information online at magnetwork.org.
Kent State University, one of Ohio's premier universities, celebrating 100 years as an engine for economic, cultural, and workforce development. That's excellence in action. It's happening every day at Kent State University. Information available at kent.edu.
The Dominion Foundation. JumpStart, working with entrepreneurs to accelerate the growth of their high-potential businesses to create a more prosperous economic future for Northeast Ohio. The Raymond John Wean Foundation.